Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Is my screen visible? Hello? Is my screen visible?
Yes, it's well.
Okay. So, श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः चतुर्मुख समारंभम अक्षराचार्य मध्यमं अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंतं श्रीवंदे गुरु परंपरा नमस्ते टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट हियर एज द टाइम इज रनिंग आउट लेट्स स्टार्ट अवर सेशन माय टॉपिक फॉर टुडे इज आयुर्वेदिक एथनो मेडिसिनल इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ पैडी फील्ड इकोसिस्टम्स To understand the nature of the plants growing in the paddy field ecosystem, we have to travel through the paddy fields. So let's move into the paddy fields and see what are the things happening there. Now you are seeing an overview of the paddy field. See, from this picture, you can see that the paddy fields are placed at few heights below the ground level. Our ancestors had built it in such a way that they act as an excellent resource for rainwater harvesting. So now let's enter into this paddy fields. See, on one side we can see the growing paddies, and on the other side we can see the water resources from which the water is taken for the uses in the paddy field. There are mainly two phases which can be seen in the paddy field, that is wet phase and the dry phase. After sowing the seeds, after few days they will germinate, and from that stage onwards continuous water supply is needed for their growth. This marks the beginning of the wet phase. See the nature of the soil. It is predominant in prithyap tattva. Now you can see a not mature paddy about 90 days years old. This is another picture of paddy which is about to harvest 110 days old. And after the harvesting, this paddy field is let free, and the old water of the paddy field is dried up, and it marks the beginning of the dry phase. So now let's look out into the importance of the paddy field ecosystem. As I told earlier, it is very much essential for the rainwater harvesting. As a result, this clogged water bodies helps in the recharging of the groundwater, and it also helps in the prevention of flood, control of soil erosion, and the mitigation of the local climatic variability, as the specific heat of the water is much higher. And also it is an available source of many indigenous medicinal plants, and it also helps in the establishment of the condition for the fish cultivation, and it also helps in the establishment of the habitats for wildlife including aquatic flora and fauna. Now these are some of the species of the plants which I had noticed during the survey in the paddy fields. Hediotis corymbosa, Parpadaga pulle, Hediotis herbaceae, Monganam pulle, Cyanodendactylon, which is commonly known as Durva, and Cypress rotundus, Alternandra sessilis, Marsilia cordifolia, Nalilachira or Chatushpatri, Oxalis corniculata, Eclipta alba, Alternandra sessilis, Phyllanthus neruri, Boravia diffusa, Potulaca oleracea, Hygrophilia auriculata, which is commonly known as Kogilaksha, Mimosa pudica, Biophytum sensitivum, Lucas aspera, Mulugas pendaphylla, and many such plants. Scoparia dulcis, which is known as Kalluriki, Cyanthium cinereum, Adiantum lunulatum, which is a source of Hamsabadi, Amelia songifolia, and Celis aromaticus. So there are many types of plants which are growing in the paddy field. This can be categorized into those plants which are growing in the wet phase and those plants which are growing in the dry phase. Now let's look out into some of the plants which are growing in the wet phase in the paddy field. The first one is Kayoni. In common name, it is known as false daisy, Eclipta prostrata of Asteraceae family. This is the picture of Kayoni. It is one among the Dashapushpa. Dashapushpa means that those 10 small plants are arranged as Dashapushpa by the Kerala Vaidyas. See, from this picture you can see that the fruits of the Bhringaraja is similar to the lobules of the liver, with sinusoids and hepatocytes arranged in linear column. This is an example of Loka Purusha Samya. As the Charaka says, Yavandohi Loka Bhava Vishesha Stavanda Purushe. And in practice also we can find excellent liver protective function of the Bhringaraja. One Dravya which is acting as a liver protective function, it should be Rakta Prasadana as well, as liver is the Sroda Moola of this Rakta, Rakta Dhadu. And any Dravya which acts as Rakta Prasadana should be Tuk Prasadana as well, as per the Ayurveda Sharira. And also we can notice many ethno-medicinal uses of this Bhringaraja related to that liver protective function. One of the uses, the Swarasa of the Bhringaraja is useful in disorders associated with Yakrut and Pleha. And another use is Bhringa Laksha Arakam. This information was shared by dear Rajan sir in the previous Aranyaka. I will explain. When this liver or spleen having this type of degenerative changes, it should be replaced along with the Bhringaraja. We should use some type of sandhaniya drugs. So laksha is added. Laksha is added in equal quantity, and it is stay, and both of them are soaked in water. And on the next day, double quantity of water is added, and an arka is prepared. During the arka formation, this filtrate is made to fall on lavanga, and after that, this filtrate is used. This filtrate have an excellent capacity for the regeneration of the liver cells. And another folklore practice is the yakrut formation, yakrut preparation made of this Bhringaraja. Half kilo of the goat liver plus half liter of this Bhringa Swarasam is taken and it is boiled. And this half liter has to be completely absorbed, and then it will be powdered and it is dried in the sunshade. And this also works well in Yakrut Vigaras. This also helps in the increase in HB level also. This same Yakrut Yoga with addition of equal quantity of sugar or sometimes Tribhala Churna plus Madhu plus Grida is used in degenerative retinal disorders as well. And another folklore use is the Swarasa of the Bhringaraja and its paste cooked with sesame oil and applied over head is useful for eye disorders and hair fall. Now let's move on to the next drug, that is Vailchulli. Vailchulli is commonly known as long-end Barlaria, and its scientific name is Hygrophilia auriculata, belonging to the family Acanthaceae. See, these are the group of Vailchulli growing so happily. And see the thorns of this plant. It is known as Kogilaksha also because the flower bud in budding stage, it is similar to the aksha of Kogila. That is why it is known as Kogilaksha. See, in this picture, you can easily see that the swollen interpetiolar joints and the sharp thorns of this Kogilaksha look resemblance with that of the swollen joints and the uric acid crystal accumulation in the joints of a gout patient. This is an another example of Loka Purusha Samya. And also it acts wonderfully in such type of conditions. Generally, it is observed that the plants with prominent joints are good for joint pain, and that with thorns are more specific in penetrating action on that site. Acharya Vagbhata has also said in Vadashonda Chigilsa that Kogilakshaka Nidyuha Pidastat Chaga Bhojina Kribhabhyasa Iva Krodham Vadaraktam Niyachyati. This loga itself calls for the importance of the Kokilaksha in the treatment of Vadashyonda. All these are the application of the Pratyaksha Pramana. Its application starts from the ecology of the land itself. See, both these plants, that is Bhringaraja and this Vayal Chulli, they are growing in a land where there is more of the Jaliya Amsha is there. And the mud, as I had showed earlier, the mud is with Prithvi Aptatva predominant. So the plant will surely will have the influence of that. And also to cope up with such increase in the Aptatva, these plants develop an increase in Agni Mahabhuta also. So such type of drugs with the balance of these Mahabhutas can be useful in the diseases like Vadarakta. And paddy field ecosystem is a great source for that. Another such examples are Trinapanjamula, Kandaka Panjamula, etc. The kashaya made with roots of Vayal Chulli is useful in Shobham and Kamala. The Bija Churna of Vayal Chulli, the Bija of Vayal Chulli, you can see that if you add a small quantity of water into the Bija, they will absorb all the water and it will turn into a thick mucilaginous form. That much Snigdhatva is present in the Bija of Vayal Chulli. They are excellent Vrishya Drivyas. The Bija Churna of Vayal Chulli and Atmagupta, in Malayalam it is known as Nayakurna Paripu, Vicuna Pruriens. They both of these seeds are mixed and made into a churna and they are taken with milk. This helps in Shuklavirdhi. Now moving to the next plant, that is Puliyariya. It is supposed to be the one among the grandma's kit in our homes and it is easily available, less expensive and easy to use. And it is commonly used in chutney preparation. Puliyariya is a creeping wood sorrel. Its scientific name is Oxalis corniculata, belonging to Oxalidaceae family. See the pictures of Puliyariya. In Sanskrit, it is known as Changiri. And Acharyas had mentioned Changiri as Ashohida Drivya and also Grahini Hida Drivya. It is also included in Chaga Varga by Acharya Vagbada and as well as Charaka. It is a small leafy vegetable with soft taste, amla rasa, and hot potency, ushnavirya. The paste made of this Puliyariya is mixed with takram, which is useful in adhisara. And the curry made by its leaves are good in grahini. These all are folklore uses, which I had got by asking with the local people, which I had met in the paddy fields. Another is leaves and stem of the plant cooked with buttermilk are good in bleeding piles. The sorasa of the leaves is mixed with honey and salt and this mixture is stirred in water for dehydration. Dehydration in adhisara conditions. So the last point is very important, I think. The sorasa of the leaves is mixed with honey and salt and this mixture is stirred in water for dehydration conditions. And the next drivya is Neeraral, four leaf clover. It is also known as Nalila Chira, Marsilia quadrifloria, belong to the family Marsiliaceae. You can see the similarity between the Changeri and this plant. It is also known as Sunishanaga. Here it has four leaves, whereas Changeri has six leaves. It is a pteridophyte. As I told earlier, it is a plant similar to Changeri but has four leaves and it is seen on the aquatic area. It is also known as Sunishanaga. And it has Madhura Rasa. Compared to Changeri, it has Amla Rasa, but Neeraral or Chatushpatri has Madhura Rasa and it acts as Rakta Stambhana. Especially in uterine bleeding, it is used. It is common in Vaidhyamadam family. One traditional usage is there, especially uterine bleeding, that is the proper way of intake should be in empty stomach. It is added with butter and sugar candy, followed by drinking cow's milk as an adjuvant. It is also one among the drivya which are mentioned as desirable for regular use by Acharya Vagbada in the chapter Matra Shidiya. Chile Chali Goduma, that sloga is starting like that. And Acharya Vakbada has also mentioned Sunishanaga as a Vrishya property drug. As Sunishanno Aknikrit Vrishyasteshu. And we can find a folklore use also. The leaf juice mixed with ginger juice and honey for sperm production. The leaf juice of this Chadushpatri mixed with the ginger juice and honey is given for sperm production. Next, let's move on to the plant Karingu Valam. It is known as false pickerel wheat and Monocoria vaginalis Pondereraceae family. This plant can be seen submerged in the water resources which are seen around this paddy field. See the color of this plant. Beautiful neela varna. It is known as, in Sanskrit, it is known as Indivara, a plant originating from nearby water sources in paddy field with neela varna. It is Pittahara and Shidaviri also. The source of this Karingu Valam is useful in Abasmara like conditions. Another use which is shared by Rama teacher in previous Saranigam is that the Tailabhaga of this Indivaram along with plantain stem juice, that is Vaalapindi Neer, it is useful in burn injuries. Now next drug is Muttapayal. It is called as water lettuce, Pistia stratiotus Araceae family. This water lettuce is very important by its function, phytoremediation. In the left corner, you can see the Muttapayal, which I had seen during the survey. See the structure of this plant. I think due to this structure, it is called as Agasha Tamara also. It is called as Jalakumbi in our books, and it is also known as Agasha Tamara. It is Pittahara, and from some folklore uses are the ashes of this plant are applied to the ringworm infection of the skull. And the juice of the leaves boiled in coconut oil, and they are applied externally in chronic skin diseases. Now, next common plant is Muthil. Everyone know about it. Indian pennywort, Sandella asiatica, Manduga varni in Sanskritam, and belong to Apiaceae family. See the structure of the leaf. It is much similar to our brain, human brain. And also in action also it is doing like that. It is an excellent media dravya. It is one among the media rasayanas told by the acharyas. The leaves of this muttil, that is Manduga varni, Sandala asiatica, and jeeraga, cumin seeds, they are made into a paste and is given along with honey in bala adhisaram. That is diarrhea condition seen in children. And another folklore use is the churna of the leaves of this muttil or manduga parni. They are dried in sunshade and it is given for the loss of memory. Another use, 1/2 ounce of this juice taken from this entire plant. It is added with some quantity of butter and it is given to children to promote the intellect. So moving on to the next plant, it is Manganari, creeping marsh field, Limnophila repens, Scophularaceae family. See the plant. By rubbing this plant and if we smell, we can get a smell of an aromatic turpentine. Limnophila aromatica is another source. And this one is also taking as a source of Gandhira. It is Jwarahara and it is Dibana also. One folklore use of this plant is the whole plant paste of equal quantity of this Limnophila and Mimosa, that is Lajjalu. It is used in the treatment. Now next common drug which is seen in the paddy field is Velia Kolupa, that is common purslane, Potulaca oleraceae, Potulaceae family. Hello, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, audible.
Okay, sir. Here it is shown as internet connection is unstable. That is why I asked. So our next drug is Veliyakolpa. It is common parsley. That is Portulaca oleracea, Portulacaceae family. You can see the plant here. It is known as Brihat Ploniga. It is Pittahara and also Gulmahara. As I told earlier, those plants which are growing in this paddy field, especially in this wet phase, they will give coolingness to our body. The plant extract is useful in the treatment of burns and diseases related to intestine. This Kolpachira Thoran, a curry, which is common among the local people. It is given for many conditions like abdominal problems to strengthen the immune system, etc. Now, let's move on to the dry phase. What are the plants which are seen in dry phase in the paddy field ecosystem? In dry phase, as I told earlier, after harvesting, the paddy field is set free and all of the water is dried up by the sun in the summer season, etc. So let's move on to the plants which are seen in the dry phase. The first one is Adakkamaniyan. Adakkamaniyan is called as East Indian Globe Thistle and belonging to the family Asteraceae. Its scientific name is Spiranthus indicus. In our Samhita, we can see two types of Adakkamaniyan. One is Mundi and another one is Shwethamundi, but in Kerala, we can see another variety, Manya Adakkamaniyan. I'm sure to call it as Peedamundi. It is mentioned in Hortus Malabaricus. So let's see. Now moving on to the Adakkamaniyan, the first plant. This is Adakkamaniyan. It is having a bluish purple color. It is called as Mundi. Why it is called Mundi? It is because of the flower head. Because of the flower head is in spherical shape, that is why this plant is called as Mundi. It is common when this water is completely dried up. Okay, and see, it is also taken as a source of Shravani. It is also known as Bhumi Kadamba. Sorry for that mistake. It is called as Bhumi Kadamba. It is an excellent insect repellent plant. If we press the leaf of this plant, it is very sticky. That much pichirida is there. For cough, the moola churna of this mundi is given along with honey in muhur muhur aushadha kala. It is a popular use. And another use is the powder of the leaves dried in sunshade is used for syphilis. Another use is it is useful in the uterine fibroid because of that types of growth. Just see the structure of this mundi. So I think another Logopurusha Samya, I think we can correlate. It is useful in uterine fibroids because of that types of growth inside the uterus. The kshara of this mundi is also useful in ashmari and gallstones. And another important use of this mundi shared by dear Ajayan sir is that it is very good in kidney related disorders. For the regeneration of the kidney cells, the powder of this mundi is given in kanyi or milk. Sir told this information was shared by a Swamiji in Madhutamala in last year's Aranyakam. So let's move on to the our next plant. It is Velutha Adakkamaniyan. It is a rare plant. It is called as African Globe Thistle. Spiranthus africanus, belong to Asteraceae family. See, this is the plant. Apart from that, here the color of the head inflorescence is white in color. That is why it is called as Shwethamundi by our Acharyas. It is a divine plant and it is taken as a source of Mahashravani. It is Rasayana and some Vaidyas use the powder of this drug for curing breast cancer also. and is aphrodisiac, and the whole plant is used in pythic abhasmara conditions. So now let's move on to the other adakamaniyan which I had noticed, manya adakamaniyan. It's called as Madras carpet, Grangia madrasapatana, belong to the family Asteraceae family. See how happily they are growing in the field. All of these plants are manya adakamaniyan, and some of the shweta adakamaniyan is also seen. See the flower of this manya adakamaniyan. The juice of the fresh leaves of this Grangia madrasapatana is instilled into ear for earache. It is used traditionally for rheumatism in knee joint and pain in the muscles. Moving on to our next plant, it is very common among public. It is Tottavadi. Touch me not plant, Mimosa pudica, belong to the family Mimosidae. Here it is the plant. It is also called as Namaskari, because when an external stimulus is applied to this leaves, the plant bent forwards. That is why it is known as Namaskari. It is also known as Lajjalu or shame plant. It is an excellent rektasthambana dravya. It is also useful in Ashmedi. The sarasa made out of the whole plant is given with tender coconut water in bronchilasma. The taila made out of this namaskari is good in throat vigaras. The root decoction gargled for gum problems and toothache. I think the last use can be also correlated with the Logapurusha Samya. By the name itself, as I told earlier, the leaves when touched, it will fold in the upward direction. Generally, toothache will occur when the tooth is not fixed in the gum, right? So I think it will help in the contraction of that gums. So thus, it helps in the curing this toothache. Another plant is Mukwitti, little tree plant, Biophytum sensitivum, belonging to the family Oxalidaceae. See this plant. It is called as Viparidala Jalubaya or Ajarya. It is also a rektasthambana dravya. And why it is called as Viparidala Jalu? If an external stimulus is applied to this plant, the leaves will be folded in downward direction. But in Lajjalu, it will fold in the upward direction. But here, it will fold in the downward direction. The leaves are made into a paste and is given in takram, in abhisara-like conditions. The kalkam of the whole plant is applied over fresh wounds. It will help in quick healing. And another important phenomenon explained by our acharyas. Sammilanam adbhi, unmilanam tejasa. In these plants, as I told earlier, when an external stimulus is applied, we can see the closing of the leaves. This closing of the leaves is done by the predominance of the Jala Mahabhuta. And this opening of the leaves is done by the Agni Mahabhuta or the Ushnatva. In Lajjalu and Vibrida Lajjalu, there is a great balance between this Jala Mahabhuta and Agni Mahabhuta. So these plants can be given in bleeding disorders. So our next plant is Tumba. It is commonly called as Tumbai, and the scientific name is Lucas aspera, belonging to the family Lamiaceae. See, by the color of the plant itself, the white is the color of purity, right? A plant occurring in this paddy field ecosystem with white color and excellent properties to clear the channels, the srodas, which is clogged with impurities. And her name is Tumba, Drona Pushpi. It is an excellent srodha shodhana dravya. Vishama Jarakna, by the action called Vishama Jarakna itself, you can decipher the Shrodha Shodhana property, Shodhahara, Shirovirejana, Amahara. It is also useful in Krimi. The Swarasa, that is the leaf, the whole extract of this plant of Dronapushpi. It is used for Nasya, along with Vilvadi Gudiga in Sarpavisha. It is a prayoga used by my grandfather. The Swarasa of this Dronapushpi is used, and Vilvadi Gudiga is mixed in that, and it is used for Nasya. For Moham, one or two drops of the Swarasa of the flower of this Dronapushpi, it is applied in the eyes. For Amavada, the standard application relieves the pain and the swellings. So our next plant is Tekida. It is also known as Thelkida. Indian heliotrope, Heliotropium indicum, belong to the family Boraginaceae. See the inflorescence of that plant. It is similar to the tail of a scorpion, right? It is a source of Vrichigali, which is included in Vidaryadi Ganam. As I told earlier, the tail of the scorpion looks similar to that of the inflorescence, like. So let's see the use. The fresh whole plant is made into a paste, and it is applied on the affected area against scorpion sting. An interesting use. The leaf juice is dropped into ice to cure cataract, redness, and conjunctivitis. The leaf decoction, it is mixed with hot water in snake bites. And the whole plant, another use is whole plant is tied up in minor cuts and wounds as an antiseptic for healing. Our next plant is Cheripadi. Cheripadi, it is also known as creeping Coldinia. Scientific name Coldinia procumbens, belong to the family Boraginaceae. See the plant. The plant got the name by the structure of its leaf itself, the undersurface of a chappal. That is why it is known as Cheripadi. Cheripu means chappal in Malayalam. The backside of this plant. See. The leaves of this Cheripadian or Coldinia procumbens, it is much similar with the functional unit of our liver. The lungs, that is alveoli. See, just compare these two pictures. And also, it is found that the Coldinia procumbens is very useful in respiratory disorders also. It is commonly used in Siddha medicine as an excellent drug of choice in syphilis. There is a verse in Siddha. Dasi veedu senna taru thalaikku tariga semmayane serupadithan. It means that for the mistake made by the affairs with many women, slap with the chappal. That is, give medicine with Cheripadi. That is why it is called as excellent drug of choice in syphilis. This plant can be seen in the dry face of this paddy field. Not only the plants, the paddy field is also an excellent source of many aquatic animals, many amphibians, many mollusks, many bats, many migratory birds. We can regularly see many migratory birds in this paddy field ecosystem, and also many indigenous fish varieties are there. One among the most, the freshwater snail. It is called as Nyavanika in Malayalam, Pomacea maculata, Ambulariidae family. We can see the mollusk there, Nyavanika, and in the background you can see another small Nyavanika there. Are you able to see? See two mature mollusk, freshwater snails, Nyavanika. It is called as Akuti in Sanskrit. Or Shambhugam also. Its egg are used in the preparation of Shambhuga Palalanda Thailam. This is an information which is shared by Swami Nirmalananda Giri during a class. And it is an excellent medicine for the regeneration of the brain cells. Shambhuga Palalanda Thailam. Also, it is an ingredient of Tadaga Shukti Saradi Grudam, told in Prana Shukla for Dhara and Akshidarpana. It is an excellent source of calcium, and it is also Pramehagna, and it is also Gulmahara. As I told earlier, we can see many, many types of birds, fishes, amphibian, molluscs, etc. in the paddy field ecosystem. Most of the plants in the paddy fields, these paddy fields are seen on the borders of this paddy field and on the pathways. So we have to inform these workers not to use these pesticides or weedicides over there to conserve these plants. And proper education must be given to the farmers about the importance of these medicinal plants. And this paddy field ecosystem provides the appropriate housing system for many species growing there. And it is the home of large number of species, and such a place with large biodiversity needs to be conserved. We know that each company needs hundreds or thousands of kilograms of raw medicine for the preparation of many Ayurvedic formulations. And in Ayurveda, a large number of raw drugs are coming from this source, that is our paddy field. So conserving this ecosystem is very much essential in the current scenario. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Namaste.
Thank you, Ram. And that was the last presentation for the second day of Haranigam 2020. Now it's actually the time to discuss the questions in the chat box. And I think all of them were answered so far. So I hope, let's conclude today's session. So let me use this opportunity to thank each one of you for your glorious presence and cooperation. Thank you, everyone. We look forward to your presence and hope that all will join us tomorrow at 5 p.m. IST. Thank you all.